Good evening, everyone. How are you? How are you? Hello. Hi, my name is Tina Chang, and I'm the master of ceremonies for this evening. We have so much to celebrate. The feeling backstage is so electric and so happy. I could feel everybody's goodness backstage. I'm so happy to be with you tonight. But the first order of business is to welcome some wonderful people that are coming onto the stage right now. These individuals who'll be in many ways running the show. Ladies and gentlemen, can you help me please give a warm welcome to the winners and presenters of the 2016 Penn Literary Awards. Thank you. I now have the great opportunity to introduce the director of the creative writing program at the New School, Luis Jaramillo.
Thanks, Tina. So I'll be very brief because I just want to thank everyone for coming. We at the New School are always very happy to help celebrate an organization and celebrate writers who are interested in a just world. I do want to thank a couple people in particular. This is a ton of work. Paul Morris and Ariel and Emma at Penn have done an amazing job. I'd also like to thank the Penn board here at the New School, Lori Lynn Turner, Ben Fama, Randy Brown Jr., Julie Goldberg, and in the booth, Joe Carney and Brian Case. And now it's my pleasure to hand the mic back to Tina Chang. Thanks, Tina.
Thank you. Welcome again to the 2016 Penn Literary Awards. I'm your host, Tina Chang. For those of you who do not know me, I have been the Poet Laureate of Brooklyn since 2010, and I've been, thank you, and I've been serving so proudly. Many people ask me what I do in this position, and it's a position that actually has no traditional job description, no office, no desk, no salary, but it's the most extraordinary unpaid job I've ever had. Because I get to work with writers. Writers can range from the age of 4 to 94 and beyond. So I get to work with the little ones who are holding a pencil for the very first time, if you can imagine, trying to make their very first letter. Or I'm working with writers at the peak of their careers and on through the later stages in life, where, for example, I'm working with writers with Alzheimer's disease who are trying to access memory again through the written word. So it really seemed like the right match to be working with Penn tonight in their efforts to strengthen the literary community. And I'll basically do whatever they say within reason. So it seemed like such a nice thing tonight to do. But I do have to address the elephant in the room. The recipient of the Penn Sol Bellow Award for Achievement in American Fiction is Toni Morrison, and I was desperately excited to meet her tonight. Though sadly, and I'm sorry if I'm breaking this to you for the first time, she's not going to be here tonight. And so since finding out, I've been so ever slightly crushed. It's hard to be slightly crushed. You're either crushed or not crushed. So I was crushed. And Toni Morrison, she had me at her first novel, The Bluest Eye, if anybody can remember reading that for the first time. And that book opened up worlds for me. She created such pained and complex and fiercely strong characters whose presence on the page would not let me go. The main character, do you remember Pecola Breedlove? She, for me, contained the Black American experience in one tragic and tender young girl. Reading Morrison's work as a young poet made me believe that as a female writer of color, I had the right to exist. So I fantasized maniacally for about 24 hours that I would get to meet Toni Morrison. And if you get the chance to meet your literary hero, what would you say if you're finally standing in front of them, just you and them, with some minutes between you, and it's your chance to shine and to be memorable? Is it a conversation starter or a conversation ender to say, "I love your work"? Because although it's true, it's probably the most amazingly uninteresting thing one could ever say to a genius. You know everything they've ever penned. You know everything about their background, their education. You've read all their work chronologically and alphabetically according to title. And honestly, they have absolutely no idea who you are. And by you, I mean me, because it makes you feel more comfortable to say that. So that's called literary imbalance, and it's what makes the world go round. And for me, it was like a little closer to a literary psychosis that I really actually hope to meet her. So it's still on my bucket list for whoever knows her, and maybe one day we'll be introduced to each other. Something to dream about. But tonight we're celebrating Toni Morrison's contributions and also the contributions of 18 other gifted writers, as well as those on the short list, those on the long list, those who almost sort of made it onto the long list. And I know those writers, they are so grateful. We're also celebrating the insistence of the imagination. Books are humanity in print, said the author Barbara Tuchman. I believe that by being here, all of us are participating in the collective good that pen imparts every day. Human creativity is limitless, and pen pushes through the world with all of its might to celebrate the freedom of the mind. So I have so many good people to introduce you to tonight. And the first one is Monique Truong. Monique Truong is the chair of the Penn Literary Awards Committee. Besides being a very, very talented writer, she will be presenting two of the first awards tonight, which will be Penn's two manuscript awards. Please help me welcome Monique Truong.
Thank you, Tina. On behalf of Penn and as chair of the Literary Awards Committee, I would like to begin by saying how joyful we are that the brilliant Tina Chang, the poet laureate of Brooklyn, is our MC tonight. We're also fortunate to have tonight a distinguished group of award presenters who represent the diversity of Penn's membership and community. David Epstein, Louise Erdrich, Kirsten Greenidge, Meghan O'Rourke, and Burton Pike. It's my great honor to welcome you all to Penn's annual Literary Award Ceremony. Before we continue, I've been asked to kindly remind you to turn off your cell phones. As we are recording tonight's ceremony for the generations to come, who probably won't even know what a cell phone is. So, let's not confuse them any further with our outdated technology. Thank you. At last year's ceremony, the president of Penn, Andrew Solomon, reminded us that Penn's core mission, freedom of speech, is meaningless without, quote, skill of speech. We are here tonight to celebrate the writers and literary translators who inspire us with their skill, talent, and passion. We celebrate them because they remind us all that writers and translators are necessary and integral to our social fabric. They are the weavers, and their ideas are the most colorful of threads. We celebrate them because so often in America, they are not celebrated, duly acknowledged, or compensated. We celebrate them because in countries around the world, writers and translators are persecuted and imprisoned for daring, for thinking, for writing. Long before I served on the Penn Awards Committee, I was the recipient of one of tonight's awards, the Penn Robert W. Bingham Prize. It changed my life. As a then debut writer, I was conditioned to be grateful, desperately grateful. for everything. An agent, a book contract, a book, a review. The Bingham, as is the case with all of our awards tonight, was an incredible flipping of that script of indebtedness. Tonight, what you will witness that is truly invaluable with each and every announcement of an award is the sharing, the bestowing of literary courage, the courage to face a blank page again, an empty screen again, and to dare to fill them again with our words. For 2016, we've chosen to hold our ceremony earlier in the year in order to bring more and immediate attention to all of the incredible books and their authors. This year's ceremony is also special as it's the first year that Penn would be announcing live at tonight's ceremony the winner of five of out of the 19 of our prestigious awards. We made this change with the hope of bringing greater and more sustained recognition to the shortlisted authors and the soon-to-be-announced winners. 2016 was a record-breaking year for award submissions. We received over 1,200 books, manuscripts, and works in progress. We're particularly happy to note that among our 19 awards, the one that received the largest number of submissions was our Penn Translation Prize, which we see as an encouraging sign for the publication and availability of world literature here in the US. And with that, I'd now like to thank those who were tasked with reading some of the 1,200 plus works, our judges. What makes the Penn Awards truly outstanding is our esteemed judges, whom are themselves distinguished writers, editors, or translators. They generously take weeks and months from their own work to read and deliberate over the submissions. They bring to their task an energy and an excitement that we at Penn are deeply thankful for. I'd also like to thank each member of our Literary Awards Committee: Akiko Bush, Ken Chen, David Ebershoff, Bridget Hughes, Steph Opitz, Alice Quinn, Paul Slovak, Hannah Tinty, and Sasha Weiss. Thanks also to the Children's and Young Adult Book Committee, co-chaired by Fatima Sheikh and Paul O. Selinsky, and our Translation Committee, co-chaired by Alex Zucker and Allison Markin Powell. The members of these committees volunteer their time and their expertise to impanel the amazing judges for our awards tonight. We on the Penn Awards Committee believe strongly that a vital part of achieving full diversity in publishing can begin with the judges for our annual awards. In 2014, two-thirds of our nearly 50 judges were women. Last year, Book Riot cited us as, quote, a shining example of how you do diversity. We are truly proud to be a standard bearer and that others have taken note. We at Penn are also thankful to the New School, which has again donated to us this beautiful soaring auditorium. To all the publishers and literary agencies who've reserved space in this year's award program to celebrate and congratulate the authors. to Bowman Rare Books, which has donated a gift to the winner of the Penn Laura Pell's International Foundation for Theater Award for a Master American Dramatist. And finally, to Creative Artists Agency, who has generously co-sponsored tonight's ceremony. We are fortunate to be working with them to support such a wide array of literary talents this evening. If you would allow me a final set of thank you, I would like to commend and to thank yet again the incredible vision and organizational prowess of Penn staffers Paul Morris and Ariel Onema, whose hard work year-long is culminating in tonight's ceremony and celebration. Without them, I'm pretty certain we would be handing out our awards at a Starbucks somewhere. Without further ado, I have the great honor of presenting the first two awards of the night. We begin with the Penn Fusion Emerging Writers Prize for a promising young writer of an unpublished work of nonfiction that addresses a global and/or a multicultural issue. The Penn Fusion is made possible by Univision. The judges are Marie Arana, Manuel Gonzalez, and Johnny Temple. The Penn Fusion is one of our five awards being announced live tonight. I would like to recognize the four finalists. When I announce your name, could you please stand? Victoria Blanco for Vision of Oasis. Laurel Fantuzzo for Archipelago Sleepovers. Jean Guerrero for Crux. Jacqueline Moyer for The Girl Outside My Window. The winner of the Penn Fusion Emerging Writers Prize is Jean Guerrero for Crux. I just whispered to her the secret code. Now that she's a winner. No, it's not true. I want to share with you, before Jean takes the podium, what the judges had to say about her and her work. Jean Guerrero's uses her exhaustive research into her paternal, familial history to craft a passionate and riveting memoir that stretches the notion of crossing borders. Where many migration memoirs focus on national and cultural borders, Guerrero broadens the exploration to include borders between sanity and insanity, traditional gender roles and untraditional ones, formal education and life experience, health and sickness, nurturing and abandonment, prosperity and poverty, and much more. Jean.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm so grateful to be here. I would like to thank Penn, Fusion, Univision, Maria Arana, Manuel Gonzalez, and Johnny Temple for this amazing honor.
Thanks also to my mentors at Gouch's Creative Nonfiction Program for their guidance, and to Jervy Turvalon and Steve Brown for believing in this book before I did, to KPBS for encouraging me on this journey, and to my mother, my guardian angel, who taught me that you can climb any mountain, no matter how heavy the load. Thank you. Gracias, Aurita Carolina, for revisiting your most painful memories. And of course, thank you to my father, Papi, for trusting me with your story, for infecting me with your insatiable attraction to the unexplored. I really do believe stories can have a supernatural power, but this can be a healing power or a destructive power. So let us be cautious when we are proclaiming truth, because if I've learned anything from writing Crux, it's that truth is a never-ending search. One story is never enough. Only by embracing this can we liberate ourselves from prejudice and stagnation and allow language to unlock the essential beauty of human beings. Thank you so much.
Our next award is the Penn Bellwether Award for Socially Engaged Fiction, founded by Barbara Kingsolver. It's awarded to the author of a previously unpublished novel of high literary caliber that addresses issues of social justice and the impact of culture and politics on human relationships. The winner of the Penn Bellwether also receives a publishing contract with Algonquin Books. This award is made possible by Barbara Kingsolver. The judges are Layla Lalami, Kathy Pouris, and Brando Skyhorse. The winner of the Penn Bellwether Award for Socially Engaged Fiction is Lisa Koh for The Leavers. Here's what the judges had to say about The Leavers. The Leavers asks whether a child is better served while being raised by adoptive parents with English fluency and economic privilege, or with his family and culture of origin, despite having fewer educational and financial resources. It is a novel that draws links between economic migration and the adoption industry, and is, according to Judge Layla Lalami, a rich and sensitive portrait of lives lived across borders, cultures, and languages, and is one of the most engaging, deeply probing, and beautiful books that Lalami has read this year. Lisa Koh.
Thank you. Wow, it still totally doesn't feel real. I mean, you work on a novel for 7 years and you start to think it'll never be done, start to question what the hell you're doing with your life, and then one day you get a phone call from Barbara Kingsolver. So I'm just really grateful to Penn, to Barbara Kingsolver for her incredible generosity, to the judges, Layla Lalami, Brando Skyhorse, and Kathy Pouris, my editor at Algonquin. Thanks also to my family and to my badass friends, many who have read several versions of this manuscript, and to my partner Jillman, who's been living with these characters for almost as long as I have. I'm so happy to be here, and it means so much to me, and I'm so excited to bring this book into the world, so thanks again.
You really have to be here, up here, to see the loved ones' faces of those that have won. It's just, it's pure heaven, just watching your faces from here. That's a Facebook photo. So thank you, Monique. Oh, Lisa. I feel like I've watched Lisa. You know, we've grown up together at the Asian American Writers Workshop, so congratulations to all the winners. I'm going to introduce the next person who's going to be presenting, and that is Burton Pike. He'll be presenting our three translation awards: the Penn Edward and Lily Tuck Award for Paraguayan Literature, the Penn Award for Poetry in Translation, and the Penn Translation Prize. Please help me welcome Burton Pike.
Good evening. The Penn Edward and Lily Tuck Award for Paraguayan Literature is for a living author of a major work of Paraguayan literature that has not yet been translated into English. The award is made possible by Lily Tuck. Thanks to the award's judges, Ezra Fitz, Amalia Gladhart, and Mark Weiss. The winner is, the first winner, I should say, is Natalia Maria Echauri Castanino for the Spanish language poetry collection, Doce Lunas Llenas, Poesía sobre la Divina Energía Femenina. And she couldn't be with us this evening, unfortunately, but she did send words that she asked us to read. What she wanted us to read. I want to say thank you to the judges who believe in my work and selected me. It is an honor and has encouraged me to continue in this path. I want to say thank you also to my mentors and to my teachers, because if today I am somebody, if today I have something, it is because of them. So thank you. The citation in part reads, Natalia Maria Echauri Castanino's poems take as their formal structure the procession of celestial figures behind classical astrology, as well as the daily horoscope. Their references to Greek mythology both elevate and give depth to a meditation on the female as at once a figure of power and of vulnerability. The Penn Award for Poetry and Translation for a book-length translation of poetry in English published in 2015 is made possible by the Kaplan Foundation. And we must recognize the judge also, who is Orayuan Noel. And the winner is Sawako Nakasayasu for her translation from the Japanese of the collected poems of Chiga Sagawa. And again, an excerpt from her citation. The first comprehensive English language collection of this major modernist work, the collected poems of Chika Sagawa, is a substantive contribution to understanding 20th century Japanese poetry. Sagawa's voice is at once world-weary and eerily contemporary. So would you come to the microphone, please?
Good evening, and thank you so much to Penn, to everyone at Penn, the judge, Raul-Johan Noel, and for the introduction, Burton Pike. I'm so delighted to be here tonight and to look back on a moment when I first started translating this work. This is in 2002, and when I began, someone said to me, and this was the general sentiment. Only one man said this to me. He said, "Why are you translating such a minor poet?" And I didn't quite know how to respond at the time. Now I have a lot of things to say. But I'm very, very thankful and grateful first to Chika Sagawa herself for sharing an amazing beauty in her work. And I'm so delighted to to be engaged with it through translation. I'm also thankful to the Japan-US Friendship Commission, who supported my project through their Creative Artists Program, and to Tracy Grinnell at Litmus Press. She was the one who invited me to guest edit a Japan feature with perfect timing, so that got my project going. Also to Canarium, who published this work and kind of gave it a whole life outside of what I could do as a translator. So I'm now delighted to say that more people have read this work in English than in Japanese. Well, I'm a little bit disappointed about various issues around that, but I'll stop there for now. And last but not least, I'm very grateful to my wonderful partner, Eugene, without whom I wouldn't be here tonight in New York among all of these incredible writers. He's holding down the fort in Tokyo with two little children. So thank you all so much.
The Penn Translation Prize for a book-length translation of prose into English published in 2015. The prize has been awarded since 1963 in recognition of the art of the literary translator, the first American award to do so. The judges for this award were Elizabeth Jacquette, Avia Kushner, Ronald Meyer, Sarah Novich, and Jeffrey Zuckerman. The winner is Katrina Dodson for her translation from the Portuguese of Clarice Lispector's The Complete Stories. Part of her citation award reads, "Katrina Dodson's translation of Clarice Lispector's Complete Stories lays bare the breadth of the author's talent, her striking varied portraits of human interaction and intimacy. The stories are diverse in tone, mood, and perspective, vividly rendered by Dodson." So if you'll come to the microphone.
I am deeply moved by this award. Translating Clarice Lispector has changed my life, and it was a heavy task, and this recognition has given me a new sense of lightness. So I thank Penn for recognizing translators and and the judges for reading those 85 stories, 645 pages with such care. I also thank everyone at New Directions who worked like crazy on this book, especially our heroic publisher, Barbara Epler, and my editor, Benjamin Moser, who's been instrumental to this Lispector series. Thank you to Clarice's son, Paolo, to the other Lispector translators, the friends who answered questions about Portuguese and English, and to my family, especially my parents, Tao and Jerry Dodson, who are here tonight. The name Clarice Lispector has been something like a secret handshake outside of Brazil, and to witness so many people talking about her in English has been the most beautiful gift. Obrigada. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Burton Pike and all the winners. Can you feel the joy? Can you feel? It's so palpable. So I was backstage hanging out with some of the winners before tonight, and one of the winners said, "It's so strange to win an award because we're going to do what we're going to do anyway, but then we all agreed it's also really nice to win an award." So
Our next presenter is Kirsten Greenidge, who will be presenting the awards for drama. Kirsten will present the following three awards: the Penn Laura Pels Award for Emerging American Playwright, the Penn Laura Pels Award for American Playwright in Mid-Career, and the Penn Laura Pels Award for Master American Dramatist. Please give a warm welcome to Kirsten Greenidge.
Hello, everybody. I'm Kirsten, and it's my pleasure tonight to present the Penn Laura Pels International Foundation for Theater Art Awards, which honor a master American dramatist, a playwright in mid-career, and an emerging playwright who demonstrates great promise. These awards are made possible by the Laura Pels International Foundation for Theater. And before I continue, I want to recognize my fellow judges, playwrights Annie Baker and Tracy Letts. Those were calls were stimulating and reaffirmed my how happy and proud I am to be a playwright. The Penn Laura Pels International Foundation for Theater Award for Emerging American Playwright goes to Branden Jacobs-Jenkins. And of Branden, the judges wrote, "Branden is a young writer of uncommon power. His work is bold, thoughtful, funny, and true. Though his career has certainly already emerged, we see his career as being filled with abounding promise, and I myself would add reaching new heights, hopefully very soon. His plays include An Octoroon, Appropriate, and Neighbors. So Branden, please come to the podium."
Oh, God. we all know each other, which is sort of upsetting. But I want to definitely thank Penn for remembering the brethren who live in, basically live in a space like this, day in and day out, not getting any vitamin D. I admire this organization so much, and I think it's so important that we get to be awarded by our peers, which almost never really happens in the theater. So this is a very meaningful award to me. I also want to thank my family, specifically my very tiny family. My mother, my brother, my sister is missing, but my mother and brother are here. And I want to thank them for all the emotional material they've given me. And I want to thank my partner, Cheo, who's also here, who's given me another kind of emotional material, which is good, too. And I think I also want to thank Jim Houghton, who is artistic director of Signature Theater and also the head of the Juilliard Drama Division. And this man has been my kind of fairy godfather for the last umpteen years of my career. And I want to thank Sarah Benson and Sarah Stern from the Soho Rep and Vineyard Theaters, respectively, for taking a chance on me when I was literally sleeping on an air mattress in Prospect Heights with whooping cough. So those people matter. So thank you very much.
Our second award is the Penn Laura Pels International Foundation for Theater Award for a Mid-Career American Playwright, and it goes to Young Jean Lee. Young Jean Lee, the judges wrote, "By tackling themes and projects that initially strike her as nightmarish, Miss Lee writes and directs theater that has a raw, honest vulnerability that is unprecedented in the American theater. Her dissection of the relationship between the performers and the audience is always strange, scary, and yet remarkably inclusive. The judges, like the audiences that are inspired by her work, can't wait to see what she comes up with next. Her plays include Straight White Men, We're Gonna Die, and The Shipment and Lear. And it's an honor to present this award to Young Jean Lee tonight.
While I was sitting at that table, my leg kept falling asleep, and I was just terrified that when I stood up, I was going to collapse. So first of all, I'm just grateful that that didn't happen. I would like to thank Penn for making it be the case that I'm mid-career. Nobody's ever said that before. I was always emerging, so thank you. Now I'm mid-career, and I'd like to thank the judges. I'd like to thank my dramaturg, Mike Ferry, who has worked with me on everything I've ever done. Mostly, I would like to thank anyone who has ever contributed in any way to the world of downtown theater, which is this weird place where people support total artistic freedom. And everything that I've ever made has been a sort of collective product of this community. So thank you so much.
The third and final award is the Penn Laura Pell's International Foundation for Theater Award, and it is the Master American Dramatist Award, and it is being presented to Lynn Nottage. So when I was in college, I remember seeing Crumbs on the Table of Joy, and I sat there in that theater and thought, this is why I would like to continue to be a playwright. I remember sitting there with like a lump in my throat. So being able to present this award means a lot to me tonight. Lynn Nottage is a Pulitzer Prize-winning author and of Ruined. Her inspiring array of work speaks to the strength of the human spirit within all of us. In 2004, Ms. Nottage was awarded the Penn Laura Pell's International Foundation Award for American Playwright in Mid-Career. And since that time, her influence in the American theater has widened and deepened, and her awe-inspiring body of work demonstrates that she is truly a master American dramatist. In recognition for her body of work, Lynn will be presented with a signed limited first edition of Eugene O'Neill's collected early plays, including two of his Pulitzer winners, Beyond the Horizon and Anna Christie, which is just one of 1,200 copies signed by the playwright. So it's an honor and a privilege to present this award to you tonight, Lynn.
Thank you, Penn, so much for this honor, but it's a little bit frightening because it feels like an invitation to retire. thank you. I have to thank Laura Pells, who is one of the loveliest angels in theater, who is a great nurturer and supporter of not just playwrights, but of all theater. I want to take this moment to thank my family, my husband, who taught me how to format a play, and who's held my hand for every single opening since I was 21. Thank you. I want to thank my daughter, who really, when she was born, gave me a reinvigorated passion and investment in my craft. I want to thank my father, who is here, and my mother, who's not here, for giving me breath and then supporting the voice that came out of this body. You guys really push me when I was frightened to do this. I remember my mother when I was working a full-time job and I was really scared about committing to write theater, I called up my mother and I said, I think I want to do this. And she said, do it. And I just feel blessed that she has supported me from when she was here, and now I feel like she supports me every single day. And I want to thank my agent who's here, Olivier Sultan, who I lean on and who I speak to probably every single other day, and who sort of continues to push me to want to write and to be invested in this career. So thank you, Penn. Thank you, my fellow playwrights, who, you know, this is a communal art form, and it feels really lovely to accept this award sitting at a table with two of the truly great playwrights writing today. Thank you.
Thank you, Kirsten, and congratulations again to all the winners. When everybody was speaking, I was just thinking, when and who decides when we move from being emerging to mid-career? Is it age? Is it books? It's all a cloudy professional dream world to me. So our fourth presenter is David Epstein, who will be presenting our Sports Writing and Biography Awards. David will present the following three awards: the Penn ESPN Award for Literary Sports Writing, the Penn ESPN Lifetime Achievement Award for Literary Sports Writing, and the Penn Jacqueline Bograd Weld Award for Biography. Please assist me in giving a warm welcome to David Epstein.
Thank you very much. I have the distinct honor of presenting the Penn ESPN Award for Literary Sports Writing for a nonfiction book on the subject of sports, published in 2015. The award is made possible by ESPN, and it was a lot of reading, so I'd like to thank my fellow judges, Anne Killian and Dave Zirin. And the winner of the award is Scott Ellsworth for The Secret Game, a wartime story of courage, change, and basketball's lost triumph. And I'd like to read a portion of the citation. The Secret Game recounts the tortuous path to the first integrated college basketball game ever played in the South, a locked door affair between an all-white team from the Duke Medical School and an all-black team from the North Carolina College for Negroes, now North Carolina Central University. The tale is a reminder that some of the most illuminating histories can be found through the lens of sports. And I might add, it is a deeply, deeply reported preservation of an inimitable historical moment. And it's my honor to present it to Scott Ellsworth. Scott, if you'd join me here.
Well, thank you. First thing I have to tell you all is that despite the fact that she isn't here, it is an incredible honor just to be on a program with Toni Morrison. And I just want to give a shout out to her for her courage, for her art, for her genius, for her unflinching honesty, and for changing the way that Americans think about themselves. So let's hear it for Toni Morrison. Very briefly for The Secret Game at Penn, I want to thank my fellow judges, or the judges, the fellow nominees, Paul and Ariel. At CAA, I want to thank my wonderful literary agent, David Larabell, also Matthew Snyder, Jeff Jacobs. At Little Brown, I want to thank everyone, but particularly Michael Peach, Reagan Arthur, and the best editor anyone could ever want in John Parsley. I want to thank my wife, Betsy. Also, I want to thank our twin 13-year-old boys, Johnny and Will, who are not here tonight and are hopefully not burning down the house in our absence. And I just want to close with one thing. About 30 years ago, when I was starting to write, I came up from Washington, D.C. to a Penn Writers Conference at the Roosevelt Hotel, and everyone just seemed so much more literate and more refined and more mature. I came back sort of stunned and got to work, and I just want to tell all the young writers out there that you can do it. You know, make your passion your pole star. You'll find your story, and some of you will be on the stage as well. Thank you.
The next award I'd like to present is the Penn ESPN Lifetime Achievement Award for Literary Sports Writing, for a writer whose body of work represents an exceptional contribution to the field. And this award is also made possible by ESPN. And I'd like to recognize the three judges, Senator Bill Bradley, Sally Jenkins, and Dave Kindred. And the winner is John Schulian. John, for more than 35 years in sports writing, has stamped sentences on his readers' minds with the same verve and force of typewriter keys denting pages. In columns for the Chicago Sun-Times and Philadelphia Daily News, or longer, more elegiac collectibles for Sports Illustrated and GQ, he has married craftsmanship to a dead-on emotional honesty for his subjects, and an eye for the telling meaningful detail. Throughout, Schulian is wary of excessive sentiment and exaggeration that so often accompanies hero worship. And having been in sports writing, I can say that is a very rare combination of things. And John, if you'll join me, I'd like to present you with the Penn ESPN Lifetime Achievement Award.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Penn and ESPN and the judges. You know, when I got out of the Army in 1970, there wasn't a newspaper in the country that would hire me as a sports writer. I went to work in Baltimore, covering everything from cops and robbers to flannel-mouthed politicians to the Grateful Dead. And then one day, a wonderful woman named Pat Ryan, an editor at Sports Illustrated, bought a freelance story I had written about a boxing promoter who had a gym over a strip joint. Now, you can think of it as a social experiment if you'd like. Not long after that, I got a call from George Solomon, sports editor at the Washington Post, who asked me a life-changing question. He said, "How would you like to make George Allen's life miserable?" And the first thing I said was, "Are you sure you've got the right John Schulian? Because I've never written sports before." And once we got that out of the way, I should probably tell you that George Allen was a coach, and he was widely regarded as pro football's Richard Nixon. So it was my pleasure to make him uncomfortable. And just like that, I became a sports writer. And it was a wonderful time to be a sports writer. There was a revolution going on that had really started after World War II with giants of the business like Red Smith, W.C. Hines, Jimmy Cannon, John Lardner. And then the advent of Sports Illustrated in the mid-50s, and then suddenly in the 60s and 70s, you had wonderful sports sections popping up all over the country. And in these wonderful sports sections were editors who would give writers a chance to find their voice, to write with style and wit and courage, to have a social conscience. Some of these editors also had problems with geography, so you'd be covering a ball game in Dallas and you'd get a call and they'd say, "Dallas is close to Seattle, isn't it?" And you'd say, "Well, no, not really." The next thing you know, you'd be on an airplane to Seattle. So you built up your frequent flyer miles. In my case, I have any number of editors to thank. Marty Kaiser at the Chicago Sun-Times, Rob Flader and Chris Hunt at Sports Illustrated, John Walsh and Jay Lovinger at Inside Sports, Art Cooper, Paul Scanlon, and Elliot Kaplan at GQ. They let me follow my instincts, my funny bone, and my heart when I wrote things. And I was lucky enough to work in an era when there were actually athletes who talked and had something to say. Pete Rose, Reggie Jackson, Earl Weaver, the wonderfully feisty manager of the Baltimore Orioles. But none was better than Muhammad Ali, who was the most singularly amazing human being I ever covered. A day or two before his disastrous fight against Larry Holmes in Las Vegas, we were in his suite at Caesar's Palace, and somehow I wound up sitting on the sofa next to him. Dave Kindred, then of the Washington Post, was on the other side of Ali. And I reached a point in the press conference where I'd heard all the answers to all the questions, and so I just started looking out at this teeming mass media thing going on. And suddenly a large hand appeared in front of my face, and it was Ali. And he was rubbing his thumb and forefinger together, making a sound like a cricket. And I looked over at him startled, and he wagged a finger under my nose and said, "Pay attention, white boy." It was moments like that that make sports writing so much fun. And it's moments like this when I get to take my place where Roger Angel has stood and Frank DeFord, Dan Jenkins, Dave Anderson and Bob Ryan. And it proves once and for all that sports writing really was worth the wait. And I thank you from the bottom of my calcified heart.
And finally, I'd like to present the Penn Jacqueline Bograd Weld Award for a distinguished biography published in 2015. I'd like to recognize the award donor. This award is made possible by Rodman L. Drake and Jacqueline Bograd Welb. And to recognize the judges as well, Neil Irvin Painter, Deborah Solomon, and Simon Winchester. The winner of this award is Nancy Princenthal for Agnes Martin, Her Life and Art. Agnes Martin, one of the leading abstract painters of the 20th century, is known for spare contemplative paintings that typically consist of straight lines inscribed on a canvas. Nancy Princenthal, a veteran art critic, has appropriated Martin's measured style as her own in her fascinating biography of the artist. Among the book's many virtues is its refusal to sensationalize mental illness. rather than exploiting the facile cliché that views madness as a source of artistic inspiration, Princenthal explains how Martin's illness threatened to derail her art and had to be overcome. And it's my honor to present to Nancy Princenthal the Penn Jacklyn Bograd Weld Award.
So I'm not going to be the first person to stand up here and say it's just an amazing honor to be part of this community. I couldn't feel luckier, more privileged, happier to have the honor given to me by this incredibly distinguished trio of writers, Nell Irvin Painter, Deborah Solomon, Simon Winchester. I find myself in an equally remarkable bunch of biographers. I think my first real thank you has to be to Agnes Martin for the transcendent painting she made, for the example of her really rather extraordinarily courageous and determined character. This book's kind of surprising success has shown me how many people share my admiration, so that's been enormously gratifying. In bringing this book into being, I owe a huge debt to everyone at Thames and Hudson, Will Baliot, Christopher Sweet, Elizabeth Keane, Harry Burton, thank you. They've all been absolutely wonderful. The terrific editor, Christopher Lyons, supported this book from the very beginning. A very special thank you to him, as well as to the book's designer, Mark Melnick, for making it look so good. For sage advice, I thank Eric Raymond. And I particularly thank many of Agnes's friends and colleagues and several Martin scholars who were extraordinarily generous with their time and invaluable information. More grateful than I can say for that as a first-time biographer. Finally, I could not have written this book without the patience and the kindness and some timely reality checks from my husband and my son. They're both here. My deepest thanks go to you. Thank you.
Nancy, your award. It's getting, see, we share everything. It's the time that I was really looking forward to tonight. I get the chance to introduce and present three awards for the evening. Do you remember what it was like to be young? I wish I did. I have two really spirited and beautiful children who are at home right now sleeping, but they have in some way obliterated my past memories of the life before them, which is very strange. They're so cute, and yet they have the power to completely fragment my life. It's hard to have a conversation with a friend. Parents, you know, it's hard to have a conversation with a friend or walk down a street without it being interrupted by their endless needs, but also their endless wonder. All my life, I've looked at words as though I was seeing them for the first time, said Ernest Hemingway. It's through books that I'm reminded of what it is to experience this life of first. It's my distinct pleasure to present the Penn Phyllis Naylor Working Writer Fellowship for an author of children's or young adult fiction to complete a book-length work in progress. This award was made possible by Phyllis Reynolds Naylor, and the judges were Emily Arnold McCulley, Catherine Patterson, and Jason Reynolds. The winner of the Penn Phyllis Naylor Working Writer Fellowship is Ash Parsons, and I'll read from the judge's citation. Ash Parsons, A Chemical Distance, explores loss and trauma in a fresh format bouncing between prose and script. Justice Withern is doing his best to deal with the swiftly approaching one-year anniversary of the tragic car accident that left him with a brain injury and took the life of his best friend. Parsons tackles such a weighted plot line that somehow makes the darkness shine bright. Congratulations, Ash Parsons.
Yeah, okay. thought I'd just dispense a little bit of practical advice. If a bird ever gets trapped in your house, cover all but one window, open that window, and darken the room. The bird will eventually fly towards the light. It takes the combination of the darkness and the light for the bird to find her way to freedom. And in that regard, I think that birds are very much like writers. And so is this grant to me, light and air. I wish to thank Penn, the judges, and Phyllis Naylor for this grant. Additionally, I'm thankful for the support of my family, my sister Caroline, my husband Bob, who are here with me, and for the encouragement and guidance of my friend Chantel Acevedo, who encouraged me to apply. Thank you.
Congratulations, Ash, again. In defense of poetry, what is the role of poetry? What is poetry's place? Poetry gets a bad rap. These are the questions often asked of the poet. No other art form needs to defend itself so staunchly for its pure existence. When I think of the lives and the work of poets whom I love, Octavio Paz, Nazim Hikmet, Mahmoud Darwish, I think of the lives destined to address the sacred as much as it does the political. It's such a better use of time to celebrate poetry instead of defending it. So I'm most pleased to present the Penn Volcker Award for Poetry, which is awarded to a poet whose distinguished and growing body of work to date represents a notable and accomplished presence in American literature. This award is made possible by Hans Volcker. I can say that I was also a judge for this award, and my fellow judges were Jericho Brown and also Catherine Barnett, who I'm hoping is in the audience. And just to let you know a little bit about our process, we communicated across three countries. Catherine Barnett was in France as she was teaching, Jericho Brown was in Nicaragua doing readings, and I was in Brooklyn doing my poet laureating. And we spoke on the phone and through emails and texts, and we passionately but respectfully debated what is American poetry and what makes for a great American poet. And we each had our own aesthetics, we each had our very strong opinions, but no matter the time zone, one name kept rising to the surface as the deserving winner of this award. The recipient of the Penn Volcker Award for Poetry is Ed Roberson. And I'll just read the judge's citation very quickly before he comes up here, because he's so interesting. The author of 9 collections of poetry, Roberson grew up in Pittsburgh and has worked in a limnology lab, a graphic design office, an aqua zoo, and a steel mill. Roberson exercises the questions and tenets of the Black arts movement of the 1960s and 70s through poems that explore the expansiveness of Black life in America. Ed Roberson is rightly regarded as the lyric father of eco-poetics, and his ongoing body of work exerts a profound force in urgent times. Let's give our warmest applause to Ed Roberson.
She's already warned you, poets don't do what they're supposed to do. One of the things that you've heard and you'll continue to hear is lots of thanks. One of the things that we can't do is take this thing, live this thing on our own. My happiness has to do a lot with the unhappiness of people who are putting things together for me. We don't always thank those folks. I can thank my mother and father, folks up here have done the same thing. We can thank our girlfriends, but let me go in the other direction. Let me just look at all of our ancestors, all of our supports that have gotten here. I've got a poem that I thought I had lost, and I found it a few months ago. And I'd like to read it now. This is a poem to my ancestors. And by reading it to my folks, I'm singing it to your folks too. So this is a song. This is a song of thanks and praise. Thanks for being able to survive, and praise for the people who have helped us survive. When we made the Middle Passage, didn't we walk the water? Didn't we have the waters paved with the skulls of our grief for each other? Didn't we make it on ourselves? When we crawled under the Mason-Dixon, didn't we jump the fence over Borden? Didn't the river rebed behind us and turn blood because the bloods wouldn't tell? Didn't we make it to this one side on our other, on ourselves? Didn't we get put up when we went back down home? Didn't we hide in each other, no hotels, that we stood uppity, a chance of getting shot? Didn't we walk on the shadow years later of Emmett children who did? Didn't it make your step higher than just to walk? Didn't the westward push opening the country turn Middle Passage, trying to shut us out, panicked at the plow flat and hardness of our feet having stood on each other? Didn't we open the rock like our hearts? Didn't it bleed too to yield too to eat? Didn't it rain? I give that as a thank you. Thank you.
Now I have to pull myself together after that. Can you hear me? My children are Asian American and African American. My brother is Muslim, and so is his family that he married into, who are largely from Afghanistan. Much of my extended family is also Latin American. We are like any other American family. When we get together for gatherings, my brother is very quick to turn on the television as he has to have a Jets game on in the background. My children and nephews are playing two-hand touch in my living room, much to my dismay. We couldn't be any more typical, but taking my background into consideration, we would be most unpopular with certain presidential candidates, and I don't give a hoot. Nobody says hoot anymore, but I couldn't say damn, so I said hoot. I imagine that in someone's concocted world, they would build walls around us, create laws to keep us out of the country, and find ways to silence us. And I think we need fewer walls and more book awards. We need less punishment for what women choose to do with their bodies and more recognition for what they accomplish with their intellect and will. I believe that we need not take back America, but instead give abundantly and fairly to the communities that have built this country. It is due in part to my background that I search for diverse stories and characters of color wherever I go. As I visit bookstores and libraries with my children, one thing becomes pretty apparent pretty quickly, and that there are so few books for children of color. And for a child, this is devastating as they quickly learn to devalue themselves, as they do not see a positive semblance of themselves anywhere. As one moves into adulthood and sees the trend continuing, one begins to wonder who's at the helm, why aren't things changing, and what force will turn the tide of privilege. My hope is that in the not too distant future, our books will reflect the true demographics of America. Penn is a tremendous part of that vision as it promotes ongoing dialogue about publishing and diversity, as it works for equal representation so that writers of every background feel that they have a rightful place in the American literary landscape. This is why I am so deeply proud to present the Penn Open Book Award, which is awarded for an exceptional book-length work of literature by an author of color published in 2015. And the award is made possible by Rochelle Ratner. The judges for the Penn Open Book Award were Rachel Liza Griffiths, Celeste Ng, and Hector Tobar. Finalists, this is how it's going to go down. We're going to call you, and you're going to rise, and we will congratulate you and clap for you and sing your praises. So as I call your name, please stand up. The finalists of the Penn Open Book Award are Rick Barrett for Chord. Woo! Reginald Dwayne Betts for Bastards of the Reagan Era. V.V. Francis for Forest Primeval Poems. V.V., where are you? Marie Mutsuki Mockett for Where the Dead Pause and the Japanese Say Goodbye, A Journey. Yay, there she is. Laurette Savoy for Trace, Memory, History, Race, and the American Landscape. And the winner of the Penn Open Book Award is Rick Barrett for Chord.
I'm just going to say a couple of words
okay. So Rick, I'm going to go a little off script because no award ceremony is fun unless you go a little off script. So Rick, I've read all of Rick, I love your work, and I've read everything from The Darker Fall to Want and Chord especially. It's been a wonderful year for Rick. He recently is a recipient of a Guggenheim Fellowship. He won UNT's Rilke Prize, and everything is so richly deserved. I followed his work, and all of his books are such a master's class in poetry. What the judges have said about his work is Chord is about finding resonances. It's a collection of startling beauty that deepens with each rereading. Congratulations, Rick.
Thank you so much, Tina. I can't believe it.
I'm sorry, I want to turn that off.
Oh, there's more.
Yes, there's
okay. I feel profoundly unprepared for this. I'm so grateful to Penn for this incredible honor, especially to the judges of the award, Rachel Eliza Griffiths, Celeste Ng, and Hector Tobar. I'm also very grateful to Saraband Books, the publisher of my three books, for supporting my work over many years. Small publishers like Saraband, in their beautiful fashion, helped make the world go round. When you receive a recognition like this award, I believe it turns you into a kind of prism for the people and stories that have brought you to the present. The honor seems singular, but its resonance is profoundly plural. Very quickly, I want to highlight a couple of the facets of that prism. The titled poem for Chord is an elegy for my grandmother, Consortia Alvarez Barrett. When she died in 2005, my grandmother was 92 years old. For 46 years of those 92 years, she was a third grade teacher in the Philippines before immigrating to the United States in her 60s. My grandmother was a teacher who had, I am told, a generous and very firm hand with her students. The teaching she gave me came from her intense attention, which I understood, even when I was very small, was also love. And so this award is for her. This award is for family. This award is also for friendship. Chord is dedicated to four fellow writers who have helped me to become the writer that I am: Michael Dumanis, Rigoberto Gonzalez, Salvatore Scabona, and C. Dale Young. Altogether, my friendships with these writers add up to many decades. Decades of conversation and argument, decades of laughter and love, and maybe just a little bit of gossip. This award, then, is also for friendship and the freedom it creates for us as writers. It is remarkable that being among others makes us more of ourselves, our better selves, and so I celebrate those friendships here. Once again, thanks very much to Penn.
Congratulations again, Rick. I'd like to introduce our next presenter, who's Meghan O'Rourke. Meghan will present the following two live announcement awards, which is the Penn E.O. Wilson Award for Literary Science Writing and the Penn Diamondstein Spielvogel Award for the Art of the Essay. Let's welcome the very talented Meghan O'Rourke.
Thank you. It's such an honor and pleasure to be here to present these awards. Today, during a writing break that may have involved Twitter, I was reminded by somebody that the writer Thomas Mann said, "Writers are people for whom writing is harder than it is for other people." So the work of recognition and community here tonight is very important for that, among many other reasons. The Penn E.O. Wilson Award for Literary Science Writing and the PET is what I'm going to announce now. It is an award for a book of literary nonfiction on the subject of the physical or biological sciences published in 2015. The award is made possible by Dr. Edward O. Wilson, the E.O. Wilson Biodiversity Foundation, and James and Kathleen Stone. I'd like to recognize the judges, who are Joshua Four, Virginia Hughes, and Sonia Shaw. Tonight, it's a live award, so I would like us to acknowledge and celebrate the five finalists. I would ask you to stand if you're here as I read your name. Our five finalists are Cynthia Barnett for Rain, A Natural and Cultural History. Joel K. Bourne Jr. for The End of Plenty, The Race to Feed a Crowded World. Tom Klines for The Boy Who Played with Fusion, Extreme Science, Extreme Parenting, and How to Make a Star. Lauren Redniss for Thunder and Lightning, Whether Past, Present, Future. And last, Alexander Witzy and Jeff Kniep for Island on Fire, The Extraordinary Story of a Forgotten Volcano That Changed the World. And tonight's winner is Lauren Redniss for Thunder and Lightning, Whether Past, Present, Future. I'd like to just read from the judge's citation before giving Lauren her envelope. The judges wrote of her book, "Using an eclectic combination of narrative, dialogue, scientific explication, and reportage, Thunder and Lightning unearths the powerful and unexpected ways in which our lives are shaped by rain, cold, fog, and heat, and the many methods we've used to attempt to predict and control them. This is a haunting, utterly original work on an urgent topic." Please celebrate Lauren Redniss.
My husband suggested that I prepare something to say tonight, and obviously I wish I had listened to you now. Thank you so much to Penn, and to the judges, and to my amazing editor, Susan Campbell, everyone at Random House, especially Jennifer Garza, Tom Perry, Kayla Myers, Richard Ellman, so many other people. I have a wonderful literary agent, Elise Cheney, and everyone at Cheney Literary is fantastic. Adam Elgin, Sam Freilich, and Alex Cheney. Alex Jacobs. Also, just want to thank my family and my parents for babysitting tonight for our kids, and my husband especially. Thank you so much.
The next award is the Penn Diamondstein Spielvogel Award for the Art of the Essay, to preserve the dignity and esteem that the essay form imparts to literature. The award is made possible by Barbara Lee Diamondstein Spielvogel and Carl Spielvogel. I was one of the judges of this award, along with Verlin Klinkenborg and Luke Sant, and it was such a pleasure to receive these massive numbers of books every week. It was opening each one was actually like a little gift, and getting to talk to them about these essay collections and why we admired them was one of the real pleasures of this process. I'd like to recognize the five finalists. If you're here, please stand as I read your names so that we can all celebrate you. The first is Renata Adler for After the Tall Timber, Collected Nonfiction. The second is Ta-Nehisi Coates for Between the World and Me. Susan Howe for The Quarry. Marilyn Robinson for The Givenness of Things, Essays. David L. Ulin for Sidewalking, Coming to Terms with Los Angeles. Reading essays is like having an intimate visit with another mind, and one of the things that made this award so rewarding to judge was that each one of these books is truly extraordinary. We had to choose one winner, and the winner was Ta-Nehisi Coates for Between the World and Me. As Ta-Nehisi cannot be in attendance tonight, his father, Paul Coates, will be accepting the award on his behalf. We're very grateful that he could be here in his stead. Please join me in welcoming him. I'm going to just read a brief citation. From our citation, Between the World and Me by Ta-Nehisi Coates carries its radicalism, a claim against the world as it is, with amazing grace. And in doing so, it presents the reader with a moral, intellectual, and racial provocation. You cannot construe what Coates is saying without having to reconstrue yourself. In Coates's book, the essay becomes something else again, an inducement, an incitement, a persuasion to view the world that feels as gratifying in its prose as it is profoundly unsettling. Please welcome Paul Coates.
First of all, it's really an honor to accept this award and acknowledge my son this evening. I really have to thank the judges, and he would thank the judges should he be here. But Ta-Nehisi's not here. He's in France. And his whole thing in France is, someone asked him, what is he gonna do in France? He said he's gonna eat the bread and drink the wine. So while we're here tonight having a great time, he's in France. Okay? And truly, he would be back over. You know, he went over for a year, but so many things have brought him back and forth across the Atlantic. He's probably been back 6-7 times since September. And he only has a few months left, and he's really trying to get his writing in and trying to enjoy the time that he's there with his family. So on his behalf, I have the opportunity to thank so many people that have worked with, supported Ta-Nehisi, and made this award possible tonight. And I probably will forget a few, and I probably don't know some of the others. So I have to really focus on the ones that I do know. And I know that where Ta-Nehisi here, top on his list would be his mother, who he called the other day and told her how much he loved her and how much he thanked her for teaching him to read when he was 3, when he was 4. That would be Cheryl Waters. That would be top on his list. Also, Ta-Nehisi would thank, more recently, the people at the Atlantic magazine, James Bennett and the whole crew at the Atlantic. He would certainly thank Chris Jackson, his editor, who Ta-Nehisi says, without Chris, there would not be a book Between the World and Me. He would thank Gloria Loomis, his agent. He would thank Walter Mosley for steering him to Gloria Loomis as an agent. He would thank all of the people at Random House and all of the people at Spiegel and Grau for putting together such a wonderful team that supported him. He would also, as Ed has pointed out, he would also thank the ancestors who have carried him to this point and who give him the inspiration to write every day books like, and articles like Between the World and Me, and that continue to inspire him, and we hope for many, many years to come. Thank you on behalf of Ta-Nehisi.
Thank you, Meghan. Congratulations to all the winners. You know, when it was announced that Ta-Nehisi Coates could not be here, you could hear the audible disappointment from up here. Come on, it's his dad. It's his dad is here. His dad gave life to him, okay? Thank you. Imagine what would have happened if I didn't tell you ahead of time that Toni Morrison wasn't gonna be here. You would have been really, that noise would have been really loud. Monique Truong will now take the stage again. Monique will present the Penn Robert W. Bingham Prize for Debut Fiction. Let's welcome again Monique Truong.
The Penn Robert W. Bingham Prize for Debut Fiction is for an outstanding work of debut fiction published in 2015. This award is made possible by the family of Robert W. Bingham. The judges are Helon Habila, Elizabeth McCracken, Edie Maydev, and Jess Rao. The Penn Robert W. Bingham Prize is one of our awards that is being announced live tonight. We thank this year's finalists for joining us last night, all of them, for our annual Penn Robert W. Bingham Prize finalists reading at KGB Bar in the East Village, where each read from their nominated works. As I announce the names of the 4 finalists, could you please stand? Mia Alvar for In the Country. Angela Flournoy for The Turner House. Julie Iromagna for Mr. and Mrs. Doctor. Viet Tan Nguyen for the Sympathizer. Jennifer Sang for Mayumi and the Sea of Happiness. The winner of the Penn Robert W. Bingham Prize for Debut Fiction is Mia Alvar for In the Country. I'm going to make her stand there now and read to you the glowing citation from the judges. Mia Alvar's remarkable collection explores the great swath of the Filipino diaspora in 9 stories of astonishing humanity. It is a work singing with the grace of 1,000 doomed lifetimes, compressed into stories, both luminous and empathic. Technically accomplished, tremendously moving, often funny, each story bursts with brilliance, speaking from the weight of history to the buoyancy of the human soul. In the Country marks both a significant contribution to literature as well as a great accomplishment in the early work of an important writer. Mia Alvar.
Thank you so much, Monique. I do feel desperately grateful, to use your phrase, to you and all the judges for reading and honoring our books in this way. I'm so proud to have been shortlisted with this group. This book was such a private labor of love for so long, and I feel incredibly lucky that it found a team of people that cared about it almost as much as I did, if not more. And there are so many people to thank, but I especially want to call out my editor, Lexi Bloom, and my agent, Julie Bearer, and everybody at Knopf and Vintage, and the book group who worked with them on the publication. They've been such a great home for this book and such a source of support and faith for many years. I also want to thank my family for being the inspiration and cheerleaders behind the book, especially my husband Glenn, who's just the best partner imaginable. I'm really grateful to all the teachers and editors along the way who worked on these stories with me. And I just want to acknowledge also a special debt to the Filipino-American and the Filipino literary community, some of whom I see here tonight. These are poets and fiction writers and everything in between who have been working for generations out of a sense of urgency and love and not always visible rewards. And there are too many of them to name, but I thank them for the stories they've told and inspired me with, and also for their welcoming me so generously into their conversation, or party, more accurately. And of course, thank you to the family of Robert Bingham and everyone at Penn for supporting authors, not just in this room, but all over the world. Thanks so much again.
Congratulations, Mia. Thank you, Monique. So earlier in the evening, I spoke of my enthusiasm for Toni Morrison's contributions. I now have the opportunity to present the Penn Saul Bellow Award for Achievement in American Fiction, awarded to a living American author whose scale of achievement in fiction over a sustained career places him or her in the highest rank of American literature. The award is made possible by Michael Moritz and Harriet Heyman, and the judges were Louise Erdrich, Dana Mengestu, and Francine Prose, and I'll read the judges' citation. The works of Chloe Anthony Wofford, better known as Toni Morrison, have changed the landscape of American fiction. Revelatory, intelligent, bold, her fiction is invested in the Black experience and Black lives and the Black consciousness, material from which she has forged a singular American aesthetic. Toni Morrison not only opened doors to others when she began to publish, she has commented upon and enlarged the conversation about what it is to be Black, female, human, and universal. For her enduring command in her art, the judges take great pleasure in awarding Toni Morrison the Penn Saul Bellow Prize for American Fiction. Errol MacDonald will accept the award in Toni Morrison's behalf. Please welcome Errol MacDonald.
Good evening. Is this working? Yeah, good evening. Toni Morrison cannot be here tonight because she is honoring a long-standing commitment to deliver the Norton Lectures at Harvard this spring. She has asked me to give you her thanks. I am more than simply pleased to receive the Penn Saul Bellow Award. I am overwhelmed to be in the company of my predecessors. To have one's body of work acknowledged is profound. To be chosen by one's peers is a blessing. Chloe Wofford and Toni Morrison, we both thank you. Now, in celebration of Penn's mission and in appreciation of each and every one of you in the house tonight, Toni too has asked me to read this from her essay, Peril, in Burn This Book. Writers plying their craft near to or far from the throne of raw power, of military power, of empire building and counting houses, writers who construct meaning in the face of chaos must be nurtured, protected. And it is right that such protection be initiated by other writers. And it is imperative not only to save the besieged writers, but to save ourselves. The thought that leads me to contemplate with dread the erasure of other voices, of unwritten novels, poems whispered or swallowed for fear of being overheard by the wrong people, outlawed languages flourishing on the ground, essayists' questions challenging authority never being posed, unstaged plays, canceled films, that thought is a nightmare, as though a whole universe is being described in invisible ink. Certain kinds of trauma visited on peoples are so deep, so cruel, that unlike money, unlike vengeance, even unlike justice or rights or the goodwill of others, only writers can translate such trauma and turn sorrow into meaning, sharpening the moral imagination. A writer's life and work are not a gift to mankind. They are its necessity.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Errol. Every organization must have its tireless and fearless leader. Please welcome to the stage Suzanne Nossel, Executive Director of PEN.
Thank you, Tina. There are four people for whom who are not here with us tonight who I really find myself feeling for, and they are the poet laureates of Manhattan, the Bronx, Queens, and Staten Island, because look what they're up against. I want to start by thanking all the generous donors and mentioning by name those who are here with us tonight: Clara Bingham, Barbara Lee Diamondstein Spielvogel, and Carl Spielvogel, ESPN, Priscilla Heim, Vanessa Lilly, Phyllis Naylor, Laura Pels, Patrick Stiegman, John Skipper, James and Kathy Stone, Lily Tuck, and John Walsh. Please, let's give them a round of applause. I also want to recognize Lex Kaplan, a longtime and extraordinarily generous supporter of these awards, who died suddenly in December. His wit and his wisdom are sorely missed tonight. In addition to the 18 awards presented tonight, we will announce the winners of the Penn Heim Translation Fund grants later this spring. Next year, we'll introduce the new Penn Translation of Italian Literature Award as part of the Heim Fund grants. Who among us couldn't use a bit more beautiful Italian literature in our lives? We're also thrilled to announce tonight a new award for 2017 that will recognize short fiction. The Penn Robert J. Dow Short Story Prize will recognize 12 emerging writers for a published short story. We'll also launch a new partnership with Catapult, which will publish the winning stories in an annual anthology entitled The Penn America Best Debut Short Stories. By next year, you should all have that book on your bedside tables. I also want to remind everyone of this year's upcoming Penn World Voices Festival, which starts just 2 weeks from tonight at the Great Hall at Cooper Union. At a time when some people are talking about erecting walls to separate the United States and Mexico, Penn is building bridges. This year's festival will focus on Mexico, bringing never-before-heard in the USA authors and perspectives. We'll spotlight the toughest issues and amplify the most bracing and original voices. Please go to pennworldvoices.org to get your tickets. I also have some brand new news. I'm delighted to announce that Roxane Gay, writer, professor, blogger, thinker, and reinventor of feminism, will be this year's 2016 Penn Arthur Miller Freedom to Write Lecturer. She'll deliver the lecture on Sunday, May 1st at 6 p.m. at the Great Hall. Roxane is bound to make waves. Please join us and let her words and ideas wash over you and leave you invigorated and inspired. Penn's mission is to both celebrate and defend freedom of expression. A night like tonight is a joyous reminder of just how much there is to celebrate. But whether the threat comes in the form of poisonous political discourse, intrusions on our iPhones, governments that throw their journalists in jail, or online trolls who scare their victims into hiding, we are reminded constantly of the imperative of our defense. I usually use this moment to remind everyone of a writer in a faraway prison, but tonight I want to talk about something that's a little closer to home. Over the last 2 weeks, I've been part of a couple of tough conversations among free expression experts on the topic of offensive and denigrating speech, be it in the US campaign, on campus, in the European press, or the Pakistani blogosphere. Not all menacing speech can be dismissed as just words. Speech that polarizes, dismisses, and silences can do lasting harm. And yet, even the most targeted groups recognize that banning and punishing offensive speech doesn't avoid or undo the damage. They see that broad protections for speech are an essential shield for those striving to vindicate their rights. So what is the answer to offensive speech? Like most hard problems, there isn't one, not a single one. No speech equivalent of the silver bullet. But part of the answer is revealed on a night like tonight. The Penn Literary Awards are based on merit alone. But the books, authors, subjects, and subjectivities that this year's judges found most worthy were ones that gave voice to the voiceless, put the marginalized in the mainstream, told stories untold, and unearthed forgotten histories, even the sports writers. This roster of winners is a reminder that literature and art don't flourish in a box. Literature and art live and breathe the debates, dilemmas, doubts, and divides that dog their writers and their readers. One of the most potent answers to offensive speech has always been more speech. Counter chronicles that rebut, reinterpret, and reimagine. Narratives that show us what is wrong and false, mostly by asserting their own incontrovertible truth. Here tonight, we celebrate those works. In so doing, we recognize the power of literature as counter-narrative, as an antidote to what ails us, and an elixir that helps us discover our better selves. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much to tonight's winners and finalists. Thank you to the judges, to the New School, to the award donors, and especially to the hardworking staff of Penn. They do so much to make the world a more inhabitable place for writers. Please think of them during the year and give back wherever you can, whether it be signing a petition, joining on as a member, or standing alongside them when they need you most. I hope to see everyone at the cocktail reception following this event, and don't forget to tell someone that you love their work, which is probably the greatest award. Thank you, and see you next year.